If you're trying to replace After Effects with DaVinci Resolve Fusion, then you've come to the right place. Let's get into it. Basically, 99.99% of whatever you can do in After Effects can also be done in Fusion. It's really powerful. You can create composites and animations. It's got shape tools and 3D lighting effects. If you're not used to using nodes, then at first Fusion's going to feel really complicated. But rest assured, with a bit of time and practice, you'll get to the point where it just clicks. Anyone can learn it, and getting your head around nodes is all you need to learn in order to make the switch. So everything you would normally have as a layer will now be contained within one or a few nodes like this. And that counts for things like effects and masks too. They all have their own individual nodes. But to give you a better idea of how this works, today I'm going to make an animated text intro that looks like this. Super simple, but there's more than enough here for us to get to grips with the basics of Fusion. So to get started in Resolve, from our edit page, we're going to come up to our effects tab here. We're going to search for Fusion Composition and drag that onto our timeline. Now what we did here was essentially the same as creating a new composition in After Effects, but instead of setting our frame rate and dimensions on the composition, they're taken directly from our project settings in Resolve. You can find these if you go to File, Project Settings, and then you click on the Master Settings tab. So with our clip selected, we're then going to jump into the Fusion tab. Once you're in there, you'll see a single node called Media Out. Now the whole purpose of the Media Out node is to bring everything you make in Fusion back out to the edit page. You'll notice it's got a little orange input here, and whatever you feed into this node is going to display on your timeline. And this will make much more sense once we actually build something that feeds into this. Now, when you first open up a new composition in After Effects, it automatically gives you an alpha layer background as a canvas to work on. Within Fusion though, we need to set this up, and so the first thing we're going to do is click on this icon here. This is a background node. I'm going to click and drag this background node into the node viewer, and then I'm going to click on this little output connector, and I'm going to drag this into the input of our media out node. Now a black screen is going to appear in the viewer here, which is exactly what you want. This is our background, which defaults to black. Now with our background node selected, over here in the inspector panel, we can then start to select a color. Now if you don't see this, it's just cause you need to hit this tab up here. Now this looks quite basic, but we actually have a ton of options here. I'm going to set up a linear gradient. And if I click these little arrows here, I could start to adjust the color for each side of the gradient. I'm going to go with this magenta red combo here for now. Now by clicking on these little handles here, I can even move the position of where the gradient starts and ends. So I'm going to move them up to the corners here. Now there's a lot more this little background node can do, but I'll come back to that in just a moment. From our node viewer, this gives us an overview of what we've built so far. So we have this background generator node, and it's fed into our media out node, which brings it through to our edit page. So next, we need to add other elements on top of this. We're going to add another background node here. And this might seem confusing, but stick with me for now. Instead of connecting this one up, we're going to hit one on our keyboard. And then this is going to let us view this node independently in the other viewer here. Now I'm going to set up a little gradient here with our second background node, this time using some blues. But you'll notice that it tells us under the node here which viewer we're using to see this. You can compare this to the media out node, which is using viewer 2. And it doesn't really matter what one you have on 1 and what one you have on 2, they're interchangeable. So we just hit 1 or 2 in the keyboard, and it lets us independently view whatever node we have selected. And yeah, I understand After Effects can do this too, but when you're working with nodes, this is a particularly useful tool to know. So next, I'm going to grab this little square shape here. This is a rectangle mask. And a mask, if you're unfamiliar with it, basically lets us cut a shape out of whatever we're working on. It works the exact same way as a mask in After Effects, and we're going to use this to create our little spinning square. Now, if we were to create a new solid in After Effects and then use a mask to create a shape from that, this is basically the same approach we're using here. So I'm just going to grab the output of this mask and connect it into our background node. And then, easy as that, we have a little rectangle shape. Now I'm just going to adjust the width setting in the inspector window here so that we have a square instead of a rectangle. Then I'll dial in a little bit of roundness to the corners here. I'm going to set the angle to 45. Then lastly, I'm also just going to name our background layer here to square, just so we don't get that mixed up with our other background node. There's a lot you can do with these mask nodes. You can make them outlines only, you can have them drawn on, and this is just one of the many ways that you could go about creating a shape in Fusion. You create a background node and then you feed a mask into it. The mask nodes are very useful in Fusion and there's lots of different types, but unlike in After Effects where they sit within the layer dropdown, in Fusion they work as their own node and they've got a very easy way to identify them, and that is by the colour of the connectors. Now this is really important to remember. Blue connectors are masks. Most nodes have inputs and outputs, and the input for a mask is separate from that, and it's always blue. So this blue connection identifies that this node is masking this one. Okay, so we've got our background set up and we've also got our shape set up too. How do we bring these together so that they can both be fed into our media out node? Well, for that, we're gonna use this little guy here, the merge node. Now the merge node is the single most important node that you will use in Fusion. You're going to use it all the time and its function is very, very simple. It has two inputs, a background input and a foreground input. And it combines these together and outputs them as one. Now the background input is this standard yellowish orange color, and then the foreground is the green one. So if I take the output of our square node here and I feed this into the foreground of our merge node, and then I disconnect our background from the media out and feed this into the background of our merge node, then we've effectively joined these together. Now with the merge node selected, if I then press one on the keyboard, I can check this in the first viewer. Now to make sure it's come through to the edit page, I'm just going to connect the output and the merge into our media out as well. By joining multiple merge nodes together, we can actually start to layer things up in the same way that we would normally do in After Effects. Quick tip for you, if you click and drag a node into the chain like this, it will automatically add it in. And so I can add another merge here, which will allow us to add a third layer on top of what we already have here. And I'm going to use this for our intro text. Now text nodes are pretty straightforward. They let you add text in the same way that the text tool does in After Effects. So I'll quickly set up my font here and connect it up to our merge node and get it to a size that I'm happy with. Now let's say I wanted to add a drop shadow to this. If we're in After Effects, I just go to my effects and presets tab, search for shadow, click and drag this onto the actual text layer. Now within Fusion, rather than adding the effect to the node, we add it in the chain after the node. So if I come up to our effects tab here and I just search for shadow, then I drag this in between our text and merge node, it will add a drop shadow to our text. And from the inspector window, if I've got that node selected, I can adjust the detail of this pretty easily. I'm just going to bring this back because it's a bit too strong just now. It's not just effects that are set up this way. Something you'll find on every layer in After Effects is transform controls. Now in Fusion, we've got a node for this, and depending on where you put it in the node tree, that'll determine what you want to move around. So with my shadow selected, if I hit shift and spacebar, this lets me do a quick addition in the chain here before the merge. So I'll search for transform and hit OK. Basically, this is going to allow us to transform anything that's coming into it, which for now is this text. Now I want this to zoom in, so I'm going to go to about frame 50 in our timeline here and hit this little icon on the size parameter. I'm then going to move the playhead to frame 0 and give it a value of 0 so it zooms in like this. And if you're used to After Effects, this will be nothing new to you here. We're basically keyframing our animations. Keyframing in Fusion really isn't that different to how we keyframe in After Effects. The main difference though is how we move and adjust our keyframes. And for this, we've got two tabs we're going to use, Spline and Keyframes. The Keyframes tab looks like this. And before you get excited, no, these are not layers. They look a bit like layers, but they're not. This page just lets us see where we've positioned our keyframes. The actual order of these has nothing to do with the layering of our elements. So you can see if I open up this transform, it lets us grab and move about the keyframes, just the same as it would on our timeline and After Effects. Now, as you start to build up more complex animations in Fusion, this area can start to get very busy. So a recommendation I would give you is to come up to these three dots here and select Show Only Selected Tools. This means that as you navigate around your nodes, you could just click on them and then quickly see the keyframes. And if you command click a second one, it will highlight them both and bring them side by side if you need that. Now the Spline tab lets us adjust the speed and easing of our movements. Basically the same thing as our graph editor and After Effects. So I'm going to use this just to make a nice little overshoot animation like that. Now, I made a whole tutorial about easing functions in Fusion, so if you're interested in learning a little bit more about that, then you can click the link up here to watch that video. Now, something else that's helpful in the spline section is this little button here. It will automatically resize your graph into your viewing window to make it easy for you to see it at a glance. But with this text animation done, next I'm going to do a very similar thing with our square shape by adding a transform node into the chain here. Now this will let me control our shape size, position, and rotation, and I'm just going to keyframe in the same animation again, but this time I'm going to add a bit of rotation to it. Now this is looking pretty good so far, but if you wanted to add motion blur to some of your nodes, you'll usually find that in the settings tab on the node itself. So we've animated both our transform nodes here, so I could go in and turn on motion blur, and there's a bunch of controls that let me control how detailed that is. I can adjust the shutter angle and things like that. Now just a word of caution, motion blur can be quite CPU intensive, so a good tip is just to add it at the end after you've done all your movements. So something else you might use a lot of in After Effects is blending modes. So just to polish off our little animation here, I have this little dust overlay effect that I want to add in between our shape and the background. Now in After Effects, there's a toggle on each layer to adjust this, and this is exactly the kind of thing that we would use the screen blend for. To do this in Fusion, I'll just drag this in, and then you'll notice it's brought in as a little node called Media In. Quickly rename this to Dust Overlay. Now if I click and drag the output of the Dust Overlay into the output of the background node, it will create a new merge and automatically connect up both nodes. That's a handy little hack that I use all the time. From here, if we click on the merge node, we can adjust the apply mode to screen to get the same effect. I'm going to bring the blend down to 0.6 just to reduce it down a bit. Something to keep in mind for the merge node is that the controls in the inspector panel only adjust what's coming into the foreground input. The background input just gets completely bypassed. Now let's say you're happy with this text animation, but you don't really want any of the background stuff going on. You want to overlay this over some footage in the edit page. Well, that's easy to do. In Fusion, I'm just going to disconnect everything from here on. So I'll disconnect our background node, the merge node, and our dust overlay here, and just move these to the side for now. Then I'll create a new background node. I'll connect this one up to the first merge in the yellow background input. Now I'm going to keep it black because we need it to be black for this to work. And then I'm going to dial back the alpha control to 0. And that creates a completely transparent layer. And this is really useful for things like lower thirds or logo animations that you want to keep transparent, because from here you could just have it moved up a layer and then bring whatever footage you want underneath in the edit page. Really simple. Now having Fusion fully integrated as its own page is really useful. You could jump in and out of there and just adjust things on the fly. But sometimes you might want to just start a composition or just get started with an idea. You don't necessarily want to set up a whole Resolve project to do that. What's cool though is that there is a standalone version of Fusion, and it's called Fusion Studio. It works the exact same way as Fusion and Resolve, except rather than linking everything up to a media out node, you link everything up to what's called a saver node. And then from there, you can basically just render it out as a ProRes file or a video file you're choosing. It's really powerful, and you can use that to save composition files that you can later import into Resolve. There is a cost associated to it, but as I understand, if you already have a copy of DaVinci Resolve Studio, then you automatically get a license for Fusion Studio, and you can just download it as a standalone. If you haven't already bought DaVinci Resolve Studio, you should seriously consider it. If you're switching away from Adobe, then let me know in the comments. Or if you've just got a question that you need answered, I do my best to answer everyone, so just pop it in the comments for me. And I'll see you in the next one.